Hello, Must Readers. I'm Erin Popelka. I founded Must Read Fiction, a place for people who know that life is better with a novel in hand. And I am so thrilled to be here today with Fiona Davis. Welcome.
Thank you. I am so happy to be here. Thank you for the invitation.
Oh, truly my pleasure. So Fiona Davis began her career in New York City as an actress, working in Broadway, off-Broadway, and in regional theater. After getting a master's degree at Columbia Journalism School, she fell in love with writing, leapfrogging from editor to freelance journalist before finally settling down as an author of historical fiction. Her three novels are The Dollhouse, The Address, and The Masterpiece, which just came out in August. So this is so exciting. We have so much to talk about. So let's just kind of jump right in and talk about The Masterpiece, which just came out in August. Please tell me about the book.
Yeah, sure. So The Masterpiece takes place at Grand Central Terminal, which is, of course, a New York City landmark, an iconic building. And the book is about two women in two different time periods. One is an illustration teacher at the Grand Central School of Art, which actually existed in the terminal in the 1920s. And she's trying to make her way in an art world in a city that is really in flux between kind of the heady days of the roaring 20s and then the oncoming depths of the Depression.
Sure.
The other time period takes place in the 1970s, when the city and the terminal were completely different for many reasons. And that's from the point of view of kind of a down on her luck, Upper East Side socialite who's now divorced, and she has to take a job as a clerk in the info booth in the center of the concourse, which to her is the utmost in humiliation. And on her first day in the job, she stumbles into the abandoned art school and discovers a painting and starts digging into what it's all about.
Oh, fascinating. And so many kind of rich pieces happening with those two characters and as they're all coming together. So tell me a little bit more. So with both of those time periods, tell me a little bit more about the research that went into, you know, kind of certainly the feeling of those eras, but also sort of the artistic piece. I feel like that is a very interesting niche.
Yeah, you know, that's where I realized it would be a good building to write about when I learned that the painter John Singer Sargent co-founded this art school there in the 1920s. It was there for 20 years. It had 900 students a year.
Wow.
And no one had heard about it. It was located up on the very top floor of the east wing of the terminal. Mm. And as I read about that and started doing research, for example, I found this New York Times article that described this two students dashing across the concourse in fancy dress on their way to like a masquerade ball that the School of Art was having that they did every May. And as soon as I read that, I thought, oh yeah, that's my way in. That really sparks my imagination and I'll make it about the school, even though I was a little terrified because I don't know a lot about art. I'd taken an art history class in college, but it was pass fail. Luckily I passed. And I just thought, you know, let me see if I can do the research and figure this out. And so it opened me up to an entirely new world, which was really fascinating. And then the 1970s part, it was doing research about how badly the terminal fell into disrepair and how it was really at great risk because some developers wanted to plop like a 55-story skyscraper right on top of it, which would have completely ruined it.
Sure.
But at the same time, it was dirty, dark, and dangerous. If you wanted to catch a train, you got in and out as fast as you could. The ceiling, right, which in the 1920s, and luckily now, was this aquamarine blue with all the constellations. In the 70s, it was pitch black, I learned, because of all the decades of cigar and cigarette smoke.
Fascinating.
And yeah, so you had this building that changed so dramatically over time. And I like the idea of getting the character Virginia, who's the 70s heroine, kind of caught up in the fight to save Grand Central, which was led by Jackie O, of course. And luckily they fought to keep the landmark status and ultimately won.
Oh, fantastic. Yeah, so much kind of rich detail there and so much kind of exposed to the research. Were there other things that surprised you as you researched the masterpiece?
Sure. I remember reading about this part of the building called the Campbell Apartment, which was not an apartment. It was a business office for one of the board of directors for the railroad named John Campbell. And he had this thing for all things Italian Renaissance. So he decorated it beautifully. It's an enormous space with, I think, 25-foot ceilings. And there's painted wooden beams and a huge stone fireplace. And he even had a balcony with an organ for when he entertained. It was this brilliantly done space with lots of antiques and long, huge rugs. And I learned in my research that in the 1970s, it was turned into a police holding cell.
Fascinating.
And so they put up bad paneling, they dropped the ceiling. You never know about this rich room underneath it. And so there is a scene in the 70s section that takes place there, just to highlight the differences. And luckily today it's been restored to its original glory. And it's a bar called the Campbell Bar. And it's just the perfect place to go get a martini.
Oh, I love it. I love it. Next time I'm in New York, I will make sure to stop by. That sounds fantastic. So I know that some of your other two novels, The Dollhouse and The Address, also have characters, main protagonists told from different historical perspectives, which I think is such a fascinating way to tell a story. So I'd love to hear you speak a little bit more about that process and, kind of what you've learned from that juxtaposition and writing in that way.
Yeah, sure. It's such a good question. I really love to see how women's voices and agency have changed over time and how much power they have or don't have. And so contrasting two time periods really brings that to light. And I love doing the research of, for example, for the first book, The Dollhouse, I read through all these old magazines and found articles like there was one that recommended the best part-time jobs for women because working full-time cuts too deeply into the satisfactions of housekeeping. And you wouldn't want to do that.
That is also one of my problems. I do, working too much does cut into the satisfactions of housekeeping.
And so it's really fun to find those. And then in that book, at least, I created two characters that are out of their time period. So the one in the 50s is determined to do well and to have a career and never marry, which was very unusual back then. And meanwhile, the one in current day who's investigating what happened in the building in a tragedy that happened in the 50s, she's really found herself in a precarious position because the man she'd grown to depend upon is no longer there for her. And so I love that they're both out of step with their time and you can really see how things have changed or not changed.
Absolutely. Yes. And I imagine in some of your even more historical time periods, kind of one of your books goes back to the late 1800s and certainly, kind of Grand Central and the Masterpiece, like a lot of time has passed and we've had a lot of change in the last 100+ years.
Yeah, absolutely. Wait, for the Address, it takes place in the 1880s, as you mentioned. And you have characters like Nellie Bly who pop in, who was this amazing journalist of her time who was doing all this great undercover work to expose the injustices of the city. And then you have, the lead character, Sarah, who's really caught because as a woman, she has no power at that time and finds herself in a really tough, tough position. It's so much fun to go back and take things that really happened, that truly happened, but then put them into a plot with characters so you really start feeling for these people that otherwise might be a very dry newspaper article.
Absolutely, absolutely. And certainly your training as a journalist is absolutely shining through with, your research and your attention to detail. Are there more skills that, you learned as a journalist that have come to bear as a novelist?
Oh, definitely. It informed everything. I went to Columbia Journalism School and got a master's, and that really just changed the way I looked at a story and interviewing, and I was a freelance journalist for a long time, writing articles about heartburn and fitness and, woohoo.
We all need to know.
Important information. But when I started writing novels, what I found that really helped me was to really get out the way I would as a journalist and interview people in person and find sources who perhaps lived at the Barbizon Hotel for Women or get inside the Dakota apartment house and really see what it feels like, firsthand. And it's just so much richer than looking at things on the internet or, conducting an interview by email. The face-to-face really makes a difference. And that's where you find all these gems that have informed every book.
Absolutely. And probably stories that came out that you wouldn't have even thought to ask, but in person, the conversation can kind of lead you down a trail that maybe even the interviewee hasn't thought about for many years.
And, you know, in fact, it's funny you say that because one of the interviews I did for The Address, which took place at the Dakota, I was considering doing a timeline with actresses in the 1950s. And I interviewed one actress. And I ended up not using that time period because it just wasn't, I'd already used it and, you know, I liked the 100-year span better. But that exact story, her story and what she told me about being an actress in the 50s during the McCarthy era was the basis for my next book, The Chelsea Girls, which takes place at the Chelsea Hotel and comes out in July.
Amazing.
So it was this amazing piece of information and perspective that I couldn't let go, but deserved a book of its own.
Oh, fantastic. And how amazing. You never would expect those gems, but that, you know, something that isn't this book is going to be the book for, you know, kind of 2019 coming out in July. Congratulations.
Yes, it's great. I can't wait to get that book out in the world.
Oh, fantastic. And so you said that was kind of sparked by an interview with an actress. And I know that you have also worked as an actress. So tell me a little bit more about how acting in the theater also informs your writing and informs your perspective as you move through the world.
Yeah, sure. It definitely does. I think because you're used to going inside a character and figuring out an objective and, you know, all that kind of thing. I think that definitely helps when you're writing fiction to try and make the plot move forward and keep the characters pushing on to solve a problem or figure something out. Because on stage, that's what you have to be doing all the time. Otherwise, you're kind of boring. And I also think just having read a lot of plays, I understand the stage directions of moving characters around in a scene a little easier. Maybe perhaps that came a little easier than it otherwise would have. Just to keep a scene flowing with both dialogue and movement, and kind of putting those two together. So I definitely think it helped.
Fantastic. Yes. And certainly dialogue also, I imagine, kind of came through a little bit more naturally with some of the experience there. And yes, staging, like it's, you know, it's sometimes a little thing in books, but if you lose track of where people are, it's an easy thing to throw people out of the story for sure.
Oh yeah. You can easily have someone sitting in the same seat at a dinner party, which means they're on their lap. You know, you have to be very careful as to where you place people.
Absolutely. Absolutely. So with three books out in the world, I imagine that you've had a lot of interactions with readers as they've read the books, as you've brought those books into the world. Do you have any fun stories or memorable moments of times with readers?
Ooh, I have a very good one, actually.
Please.
I was doing a book talk in White Plains, New York for my first book. And I had already started working on the second one. So that was pretty much, because there's such a lag time between publication and finishing it up. And so I was really starting to think about ideas for my third book. And a reader who was in the audience came up to me after, and she said, if you like, you know, you like landmark buildings, I'll get you a behind the scenes tour of Grand Central Terminal. And at the time I thought, oh, sure, why not? And although I hadn't really considered it, because it's kind of a transportation hub. And you know, it was sort of like, okay, all my other books were set in residences where people live. Mm-hmm. And I wasn't quite sure how I would work it. But I agreed to meet her, and we were all given hard hats. And we got this incredible tour of Grand Central up to the, you know, these catwalks that are beneath between these huge windows on the east side and far below the Waldorf Astoria Hotel, where there's an abandoned train car that was said to belong to FDR.
Whoa! You know,
climbing all over. And that really inspired the book, because I think without that, I wouldn't have, you know, I wouldn't have started digging in and discovered the art school. And so I in the book, I credit her at the end for thank you for the idea.
Amazing. Amazing. Oh, well, so often as readers, we feel so grateful to the novelists and the writers in our life, but how wonderful that a reader was able to give back and inform the next book. What a fantastic story.
It was great.
Oh, that's wonderful. And so you did mention with a little teaser about a book coming out in July. Can you tell us any more about that? And it's totally okay if the answer is, you gotta wait.
No, happy to. It's called The Chelsea Girls. And in fact, let me see if I have the cover.
Oh, fantastic.
It's right here.
Oh, sneak preview, must readers. The Chelsea yeah. Girls. You are seeing it before anybody else. It comes out July 2019. Mark your calendars.
Exactly. And I'm really excited about it. It takes place at the Chelsea Hotel, which is a really famous hotel here in New York where people like Bob Dylan and Dylan Thomas and Janis Joplin and Leonard Cohen and all these really interesting characters lived. And it is, like I said, from the point of view of an actress and a playwright who's a woman. Who are two really good friends who are trying to mount a play on Broadway during the McCarthy era. Mm. And it takes place in 1950 and then it jumps to 1967. And so it's interesting because it's two different perspectives on the same plot. And it was so much fun to write and I'm in final edits and I can't wait to get it out there.
Oh my word, well, congratulations, both on the masterpiece that came out in August, the Chelsea Girls that's out next year, and for all of the great work that you do. Thank you so very much for you know, being curious, for taking tours when you're like, I don't know where this is gonna go, and wearing those hard hats for interacting with readers and for just generally, yeah, you know, creating wonderful books in the world. Thank you so much.
Thank you, and thank you for connecting authors with readers. What you're doing is really important and just so valuable. So thank you.
Oh, truly my pleasure. Must readers, please do check out the masterpiece by Fiona Davis, and stay tuned for the Chelsea Girls coming out in July. Thank you.